This is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa, and you are listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
You're with your baby.
Jason X, The Novelization of the Motion Picture, by Pat Cadigan. Chapter 1. He who fights with monsters might take care lest he thereby become a monster. If you gaze for long into an abyss, the abyss gazes also into you. The fact that the young soldier who stood in the semi-dark room had more than a passing acquaintance with the works of Nietzsche would have come as an enormous surprise to the rest of the soldiers in his squadron. Well, for those who actually knew who Nietzsche was, anyway. Even the young soldier's commanding officer, a grizzled career man who made a point of not caring what any of the men under his authority knew, as long as they jumped when he said, "Frog, you maggots!" would have raised his steel-wool eyebrows over that one. But then, when the CO had first reviewed the roster, he had taken notes, albeit somewhat absently, that the young soldier's name was Samuel Johnson. The officer was an educated man, career military notwithstanding, and it had crossed his mind at the time to hope that anyone bearing that name wouldn't turn out to be a complete moron. Since then, he had no occasion to give Corporal Johnson any further thought, which meant that the soldier had not registered with him or anyone else as being either remarkably gifted or lacking in brain power. For those in the rank and file, this is the ideal situation. And even if he were not quite as gifted as his namesake, Samuel Johnson was smart enough to know it. He was also smart enough to know that instead of standing there gazing into the abyss, he should have been sitting in the sentry pillbox across the room, keeping the machine gun trained directly on the monster at all times. Those were his orders. If the CO or one of the scientists came in and found him standing around gawking like he was in some kind of museum, he'd be in a world of hurt. Shmuel Chaim Johnson, as his parents called him, had actually been named for his maternal grandfather rather than an icon of English literature now 200 years dead. He had always been fairly intelligent, but was also practical and resourceful, and had joined the military simply to serve out the minimum time required to reap the benefits of having served his country in uniform. In particular, the benefit that would allow him to enroll in college under the GI Bill. Over the decades, there had been a number of attempts to eliminate or pare down the GI Bill. None of them had succeeded. Johnson's uncle, Geraldo, married to his Aunt Tova, suggested that the promise of higher education was probably a major factor in the continued existence of the armed forces. Although Johnson suspected that if Uncle Geraldo could have met the guys in his squadron, he would have changed his tune in a hurry. There wasn't a whole lot of college material showing up in the barracks. Of course, they all could have been in hiding, like he was. In any case, Johnson was now just under 3 weeks away from the end of his hitch, so short he couldn't see over the top of a chair, as the guys in his squad put it. Although he didn't exactly feel like he was coasting yet, he was comfortable and optimistic. However, right at this moment, he was none too happy. Of all the assignments he had been pulled during his time in the military, guard duty had never been one of his favorites. But what he was doing right now was the absolute worst of the worst. It made all the other guard duty he had ever done seem like a coffee break in comparison. The best you could say for guard duty was that it was boring as hell. It was like having to watch a test pattern on a TV screen with complete, unwavering attention. The boredom was excruciating. Your mind begged to wander, but you couldn't let it. You had to stay alert, pay attention both to what you were guarding and to your surroundings. Of the many different things Johnson had guarded over the years, warehouses, compound entrances, encampments, jeeps, payroll trucks, military prisoners, a few bridges, a general's limousine, and on one memorable occasion, a hole dug in a field. None of it had inspired thoughts of the homespun folk wisdom of the Farmer's Almanac in him, let alone the philosophy of Nietzsche. But then, as stupid and bored as he had let felt guarding a hole in the ground, it had only been a hole in the ground, not an abyss. Of course, the Grand Canyon was only a hole in the ground compared to what he was staring at this moment. And if you gaze for long into an abyss, the abyss gazes also into you. Never had Schmoll Chain Johnson understood the essence of these words so well as he did at this moment. His grandfather, the original Schmoll Chain, had once told him that with understanding came wisdom, which in turn elevated the human spirit and brought man closer to Yahuwah. It was obvious to young Sam Johnson that his Zave had never laid eyes on anything like Jason Voorhees. This monster had nothing to do with wisdom or the elevation of the human spirit, and certainly wasn't related to anything godly. It was the pure antithesis of godly. It was the debasement of humankind, endowed with brutality, not wisdom, and wasn't interested in either understanding or being understood. It sure made him wonder about Nietzsche, though. If Nietzsche had come face to face with this sort of thing back in the day, then Johnson felt very sorry for him indeed. However, Johnson hoped that wasn't the case. He didn't like knowing that he had read anything written by someone capable of only imagining the abyss. A person who could do that wouldn't have to fight a monster to become one. Either way, Johnson decided he wasn't going to waste any pity on Nietzsche. The son of a bitch was dead. His troubles were over. He didn't have to stand guard duty for an abyss, gazing at it, and having it gaze back at him, literally. Johnson knew the thing was looking at him. There was a glint in its single remaining eye from the only bright light in the room, which shone directly down on where it stood on a small round dais. If it had blinked, Johnson had missed it. The thing was completely motionless and silent, wrapped in a straitjacket that had been modified to accommodate two sets of heavy chains, one set coming down from the ceiling, the other bolted to the floor around the platform. But in case that wasn't enough, and from what Johnson knew, it definitely wasn't. The medics had set up an IV with an industrial-strength tranquilizer and plugged it right into the thing's neck. The clear bag dangling from the metal tree behind the thing was easily three times the size of a normal IV bag, and the medics had strict orders not to let the fluid inside sink lower than the one-quarter mark before they changed it for a full one. The medics had changed the bag twice since Johnson had been on duty, both times well before the fluid fell to the minimum level. They had worked fast, obviously terrified, and Johnson couldn't blame them. He wasn't quite as terrified, or so he told himself, but he also wasn't a fool. As a CO had told them at the briefing, the only people who didn't need to be afraid of this thing were already dead. So anyone who didn't want to join them had better get scared and stay that way. Some smartass, probably Danvers, who never missed a chance to mouth off, had wanted to know till when. Would that be all day, or for the rest of the week, or even longer than that? 'Cause I got plans for the weekend. Until further notice, Private, the CO had replied. His voice had been so grave that the laughter died away immediately. Until you hear from me personally that there's nothing to be scared of anymore. You want a ballpark figure, then I'd have to say, for the rest of your life, unless you don't want to be alive for a very long time. Johnson had never been so creeped out by anything, but at least it had shut that clown Danvers up. Nobody even heard him breathe loudly after that. Now he was even more creeped out as well as scared, having to guard this thing. But it could have been worse. Danvers could have been guarding this thing. His life and everyone else's in Danvers' hands. He'd have gone AWOL and the rest of the squad would have been right behind him. Putting one hand on his sidearm, Johnson walked a slow circle around the dais, watching carefully for any movement, even if it was a seemingly involuntary tick. It should have been too heavily trained even to remain conscious, let alone twitch, deliberately or otherwise. But it was awake. Very awake. Very alert, too. Johnson didn't need to see that glint in its eye to know. He could sense it. Standing behind it, He'd looked the enormous misshapen figure up and down. Under the straitjacket, it still wore the tattered, filthy rags it had been captured in. Even if anyone had been reckless enough to make an attempt at stripping it, hosing it down, and getting it into clean clothes, there probably wasn't anything that would fit, short of a tarp with a hole cut in it for the thing's head. And that was assuming those rags would actually come off. It looked to Johnson like they had grown into the thing's flesh in layers that were years deep, as if whenever its clothing wore out, it simply put something else on over it and kept going. Kept hacking, that is, hacking away with its machete, as evidenced by the dirt upon stains upon stains upon dirt and so forth. Ad nauseam in extremis. Johnson didn't blame the medics for just leaving as it was. See that thing naked? No way, man. Not for all the money in the world. Johnson walked around to its other side and paused to survey it from a new angle. The IV was still stuck deeply and solidly into its neck, still pumping those tranks in. He had strict orders to call the medics if he saw even the slightest movement, because that would mean it was developing a tolerance and they would have to give it a stronger dose immediately. So far, he'd seen nothing. Well, nothing except that glint in its eye that let him know it was awake. However, he was seriously considering calling the medics and telling them that he had seen the thing move, just so they would up the dosage. What the hell? Why wait and put everybody's life at risk? Most especially his own. You just couldn't take chances with this thing, not unless you had a death wish. As Johnson moved around in front of it again, he thought he saw the glint in its eyes flicker slightly, like the thing had deliberately looked at him, like it was watching him from behind that dented, battle-scarred hockey mask, watching his every move whenever he was in its limited visual field. Jesus, when you look into the abyss didn't just look into you. It really kept its eye on you. The fucker actually had you under surveillance. No wonder nobody had removed his mask yet. Well, he had had enough of that shit. He went back to the pillbox and picked up the blanket he had been sitting on. He might have to watch this monster, but that didn't mean he had to go on actually looking at it for one more moment. Johnson tossed the blanket over the monster's head and then stood back, satisfied for the first time since he had drawn this shit duty. So much for the abyss. "Stare at that, you ugly son of a bitch," he said and turned away without noticing that the IV bag was swinging back and forth from the hook on the metal tree. Its vigorous movements were a result of the IV tube having been pulled loose from the monster's neck to dangle freely. Fluid dripped harmlessly out onto the floor. Chapter 2. In another room at the Crystal Lake Research Facility, not far away from where Johnson had just inadvertently freed the monster from its chemical restraints, Rowan LaFontaine was finishing up some paperwork in anticipation of the arrival later in the day of a man she hated almost as much as the creature that was Jason Voorhees. No, Rowan decided as she closed one file folder and opened another, she actually hated Dr. Wimmer a lot more. Jason Voorhees frightened the hell out of her, but she did not feel the same poisonous contempt for the monster that she felt towards Wimmer. The man was an arrogant, condescending, clueless fuck with delusions of godhood. Fortunately, he would be staying just long enough to take possession of Jason Voorhees' cryogenically frozen body, and not a moment longer, if Rowan had anything to do with it. She would be only too glad to see the back of him. She would also be only too glad not to have Jason Voorhees on the premises, regardless of the fact that the restraints had held just as securely as the military had promised they would. She hadn't had a good night's sleep since they had brought the monster in, and she knew that she wouldn't breathe easy while Jason was within 100 miles of her, even after he was frozen solid in the cryo unit. Handing the monster over to Wimmer, however, still made her nervous. The self-important prick had made it clear that he looked down on her, and having to listen to instructions from her on mandatory safety measures was beneath him. It was obvious to her and to many of her colleagues at the facility that the great man was too concerned with his own standing in the scientific world to grasp exactly how dangerous Jason Voorhees actually was. Of course, some of her other colleagues felt Wimmer's reputation was reason enough to be absolutely certain that he was the best person to take custody of Jason. Her boss, Graciela Charles, was one of them, which Rowan found a bit surprising since Dr. Charles didn't like Wimmer any more than she did. But when Rowan had tried to talk to her about it, Dr. Charles had refused to discuss it, beyond stating that, whether they liked him or not, Wimmer was the top scientific mind in the Western Hemisphere. Privately, Rowan wondered exactly how Wimmer had achieved such a reputation, and whether he was even half as brilliant as many people seemed to think he was. She couldn't see it herself and was pretty sure that this wasn't simply due to her extreme antipathy for the man. She didn't doubt that Wimmer was fairly bright, but she had the impression that it was more the sly cleverness of a con man than true intellectual brilliance. If so, then he was bound to make a mistake sooner or later, a real biggie that would expose him for the posturing fraud he really was. When that time came, Rowan hoped she would have a front row seat where she could enjoy every glorious bit of his humiliation close up, in detail, and very, very personal. She then caught herself and felt her face grow warm as mild shame swept through her. As much as she disliked Wimmer, this wasn't the type of thinking she should have been indulging in. It was neither healthy nor constructive, and if she kept it up, she would accomplish nothing. She would wake up someday and find that she was nothing more than intellectual deadwood sulking in the corner of some obscure laboratory with her best years behind her, bitter and twisted and ultimately even more unlikable than Wimmer. She could think of a couple of people whose lives had gone just that way, and she didn't want to end up like that just because she couldn't stand some asshole like Wimmer. Rowan tucked a strand of long dark hair behind her ear, finished filling out the last form, and slipped into the file folder. Their mission accomplished. Paperwork done. It had taken 2 hours to do something that would have taken 15 minutes on her laptop, but she hadn't any say in the matter. Leave it to Wimmer to be one of those people who insisted on hard copy rather than accepting it all via email. Probably because he didn't know how to download an attachment. He was probably doing well to open his own email. She was chuckling to herself when she heard voices in the hallway outside her office. One voice in particular eradicated any urge to merriment. It wiped the smile off her face and sent her inner temperature plummeting towards absolute zero. God damn it all to hell, she thought. The son of a bitch was early. Then she heard a little of what he was saying and realized that it was even worse than that. The jerk actually thought he was right on time. Rowan managed to intercept Wimmer and the soldiers escorting him before they reached the room where Jason was being held. What are you doing here? She asked him, trying without success to keep her voice neutral. Wimmer lifted his chin and peered at her through his glasses, as if looking down on her from a great height, which in his mind, he was. What do you think I'm doing? He said, contempt coating his phony pear-shaped tones. I'm taking the specimen. But you can't, Rowan said, glancing at the soldiers around him. None of them would meet her eye. I haven't prepared the cryostasis chamber yet. The great man actually sneered at her. I don't want him frozen, Doctor. I want him soft. Soft as in alive? She thought. Was the son of a bitch really that crazy? Rowan shook her head firmly. We've already discussed this. Wimmer's sneer deepened into a contemptuous smile. Yes, well, I went over your head. I have the Army's permission to remove the specimen to our Scranton facility. He made a vague gesture at the soldiers, as if these were the very men who had made the decision. But Dr. Wimmer, you can't do this, Rowan said. She looked at the soldiers again, but they kept on staring straight ahead, with stony expressions, showing no sign that they could even hear the conversation. You can't risk transporting him through open country. Wimmer let out a bored breath that was quite a sigh. You have to see the bigger picture here, he told her. I've seen it, she replied hotly. Or should I remind you of the last time you tried to move him? We've come a long way since then, Wimmer said airily, making another vague gesture at his escort. Sensing he was about to move past her, Rowan stepped directly in front of him, blocking his path. No, Dr. Wimmer, I'm telling you. Look, this isn't open for discussion, the jerk said, talking over her. His unique ability to regenerate lost and damaged tissue, even to defy death, simply calls for more research. More research? That made it sound so controlled and neat and clean, practically antiseptic. Rowan shook her head. You're willing to risk the deaths of innocent civilians if he escapes? She expected him to give her some bullshit about how the security arrangements were so advanced that there was absolutely no chance of Jason Voorhees escaping. Instead, he simply looked at her and said, Yes, in a matter-of-fact tone that suggested he was surprised that she even had to ask. No one is truly innocent, he added, pausing for half a second to make sure she could see that her shocked reaction didn't impress him, before he continued. Besides, I'm sure that Sergeant Marcus and his men can handle the transfer. Right, Sergeant? He gave the man on his left a sly sideways look. Don't worry, ma'am, the sergeant said on cue. He so much as twitches, I'll blow him right into Tomorrowland. Got it? Rowan thought the man's voice sounded too pat, as if the words had been fed to him and over-rehearsed. Dr. Wimmer, please! He talked over her again with the clear edge of annoyance. You've done good work on this project. But Rowan, you are no longer needed here. He turned away from her to his right. Sergeant? The sergeant looked over his shoulder at his men. All right, let's move out. Rowan was still trying to protest as Wimmer brushed her aside. Furious at being so powerless before the asshole, she stared after him and the group of soldiers as they headed for the room where Jason was being kept. Wimmer probably expected her to trot along after them, but she couldn't bring herself to do that. If she couldn't put a stop to this idiocy, she certainly wasn't going to watch it. Christ, what a pain in the ass that girl was, Wimmer thought, as he watched the soldiers spread out to surround the platform where the famous Jason Voorhees waited in chains. Someone had thrown a blanket over him. God only knew why. Maybe the spunky girl scientist was afraid the poor boogeyman was going to catch a cold. And she thought she knew best. That was what really killed him. That little girl actually thought she had to instruct him. Him! Aloysius Bartholomew Wimmer, future Nobel laureate, eclipser of both Einstein and Hawking. No doubt in him on that score either. And he was seriously supposed to entertain the idea of that little nobody giving him orders? Not in this lifetime. Not her, not anyone. Not even Marcus or any of these soldiers, all of whom obviously knew more about what they were doing than that silly girl would ever know. Period. You could tell by the way they handled their weapons, and they had certainly come equipped. Cattle prods, billy clubs, long metal noose poles with loops slip-knotted on the end. They were all exceptionally big guys, too. None under 6'2", and all of them beefy. Careful with that 50, soldier, Wimmer heard the sergeant say, and looked over to see him rapping on the wall of the pillbox near the snout of the machine gun. You got friendlies out here, don't forget. Like the guy in the pillbox couldn't see that for himself, Wimmer thought impatiently, dabbing at the sweat that had suddenly popped out on his face. What the hell did they think they were doing? Keeping the room so hot and covering that creature with a blanket? Had to be that girl's doing. What an idiot. What are you waiting for? Wimmer demanded as the sergeant walked a slow, cautious circle around the monster. Just taking my time, Doc, the sergeant said, unperturbed. I only want to have to do this one time. He looked around at the soldiers and then made a hand signal. All right, boys, let's knock 'em out. Immediately, three guys with cattle prods lunged forward. The thing on the platform came to life with a series of frenzied, convulsive movements that continued until Marcus gave another hand signal and the men stepped back. Wimmer nodded in satisfaction as the thing went limp in its chains. So much for that big bad boogeyman Jason Voorhees. You just had to know how to handle him, he thought, as he stepped up to the platform and pulled the blanket off. At first, he thought that pain-in-the-ass girl scientist had removed the hockey mask as a childish prank, either to gross him out or annoy him, or both. It flashed through his mind exactly how he was going to rip her a new one. No, half a dozen new ones at the very least. And after that, he would fix it so that she wouldn't even be able to get a job washing test tubes. Then, he heard Sergeant Marcus's voice somewhere off to one side saying, What the Christ? And the figure in front of him snapped into sharp focus. The young soldier had not simply been strangled. The chain around his neck had crushed the flesh, bone, and cartilage into a gory pulp that was now dribbling out onto his uniform. It had happened quickly, but judging from his ghastly blue, swollen face, not quick enough to spare him from excruciating agony. "It can't be," Wimmer said, unaware that he was speaking aloud, and dropped the blankets. He turned to Marcus, who was looking around wildly, signaling his men to draw their weapons and spread out. One of them started towards the pillbox, and then stopped, short, with a look of horrified disbelief. Wimmer knew what he would see if he followed the soldier's gaze. He didn't want to see it. His mind was screaming at him to run for his life, without looking at anything. But he couldn't help it. It was impossible not to turn around and see Jason Voorhees stepping out from behind the pillbox. The heavy canvas straitjacket had split at the seams as if it were as flimsy as a trick tearaway coat in a comedy sketch. And for an absurd moment, Wimmer found himself wondering why the creature hadn't just torn the whole thing off. Maybe he couldn't get the sleeves past the broken chains hanging off his wrists. His mind gibbered hysterically. Then Jason raised the massive machine gun from the pillbox in one hand, and all coherent thoughts ceased. "Oh, shit!" said Marcus from somewhere else in the room. Frozen to the spot, Wimmer waited for a burst of machine gun fire to sweep the room and cut him in half. That would be a lot quicker and a lot less painful than what that poor bastard on the pedestal had suffered. But when the barrel of the gun did move, it collided with the skull of a nearby soldier hard enough to cave the bone in, splattering blood and tissue into the air. Abruptly, the rest of the soldiers opened fire. Wimmer could see the monster's body jerk slightly as the barrage hit him, but they might have been firing BB guns at him for all it mattered. Jason advanced on them and grabbed up the nearest man, using him as a human shield. The other soldiers kept firing, some of them sparing a few rounds to blow the man's head off and bring a quick end to his suffering. Because these were good soldiers, combat soldiers, who always knew what to do, Wimmer's mind babbled. His thoughts were racing. Good soldiers, yes. No doubt they wouldn't hesitate to do the same for him. They'd blow his head off, too, even though he was a civilian. Jason dropped the bloody, torn-up body and moved forward, raising both arms and whipping the broken chains into the air. The whirring noise sent Wimmer's nerves into overdrive, but he still couldn't run, couldn't move, couldn't even stagger back a step, could not even fall down. God help him. God help him? That was a joke. God had left the building and was currently hightailing it for safer territory, as far from here as possible. One of the chains wrapped itself around a soldier's neck, and in spite of the gunfire, the yelling, and Wimmer's own hysterical mental screaming, he had no trouble hearing with perfect clarity the sound of the soldier's neck breaking. Abruptly, Jason snapped the other chain like a whip, and Wimmer saw the end make a direct and very bloody hit against the side of Sergeant Marcus's head. It is time to go now. The thought seemed to overwhelm the roaring, screeching panic in Wimmer's head, damping it down. The pandemonium outside his head seemed to damp down as well, and even though he was still scared absolutely shitless, he was also starting to feel like he wasn't quite so frozen. Any second now, he'd be able to run right out of here. He then almost fell over as a soldier brushed past him on his right, brandishing a noose pole. Before he could even get the loop centered over the monster, the thing snatched it out of the soldier's grasp and used the end to crack his forehead open. The sound of the bone shattering was followed immediately by the whirring of chains and the sickening crackle of another soldier's neck breaking. It is time to go, now! Wimmer was on the move almost before he realized that his body had finally unfrozen. He could see a door at the other end of the enormous room, past all those ugly, pretentious pillars. It wasn't the way he had come in, and he could see one of those danger yellow signs forbidding entry to unauthorized personnel, but fuck that. He was going through, and if the plucky little pain-in-the-ass girl had a problem with that, screw her. He held his breath as something struck him, an intensely forceful, concentrated blow from behind. The monster had whipped that chain at him, he thought, caught him with the end, like a metal fist punching his spine, and, oh God, his spine. Was that why his legs suddenly wouldn't work? He looked down at himself. The 3-foot length of metal pole he found sticking out of his midsection was incomprehensible. Obviously, this was some mistake, Wimmer thought while staring at it. Then he noticed that the metal was covered with blood and viscera, which also happened to be leaking from his abdomen. He took hold of the pole with both hands, still not understanding, and replayed the last few seconds in his head. Memory delivered the painful sensation of a thin, red-hot something running him through back to front. All right, now he understood, Wimmer thought, still clutching the pole with both hands. Then memory caught up to real time and he sank to his knees as agony spread throughout him. For some unmeasured and excruciating interval, he wavered, trying to find the strength to stay upright and get back on his feet so he could make it all the way to the door down at the other end of the room. There was gunfire going off somewhere behind him, which had to mean there was still a chance that the monster would be subdued again. Jason would go down, and he would survive after all. He just had to regain his balance and not fall over, especially not forward, not with this thing in his gut. If that happened, he was screwed, but he was already falling forward. He could feel it happening even before his body began to tilt. The impact of the end of the pole against the floor sent a renewed firestorm of agony through him. This must be what a butterfly feels like with the pin through it, he thought, staring down at the floor. He waited to feel himself slide down the pole and hit the floor with his face, but nothing happened. He was still wondering what could have been holding him up at such an impossible angle when he died. Rowan stared down at the contents of the cardboard box with an edginess she had unsuccessfully trying to convince herself she no longer needed to feel. After her encounter with Wimmer, she had been too wound up to go back to her office and simply wait for him to pick up their paperwork on his way out. Instead, she had come here to the evidence room, thinking she could burn off her nervous energy in a constructive way by gathering up all the bits and pieces that they had collected on Jason Voorhees, newspaper clippings, copy of police reports, crime scene photos, a pair of work gloves stiff with long dried blood, along with a lot of other things she didn't care to look at. Chief among them was the infamous machete, which she had put in first and buried, under everything else. She couldn't stand the sight of that thing, had barely been able to bring herself to touch it, and even though it was completely hidden, the force of its presence was undiminished, as if it were an evil battery fully charged by 2 decades of bloody mayhem and murder. Someone had insisted on keeping all of Voorhees' belongings as research material. Rowan had no idea who that had been, but she suspected the real person had less to do with research than it did with plain old morbid fascination. Well, that was nothing special, and she would be dishonest if she didn't own up to having been morbidly fascinated by a few things herself in the past. But not by anything having to do with Jason Voorhees. Never that. In Rowan's view, the only people who could possibly feel any morbid fascination about Jason were those who hadn't had the misfortune to be in the same room with him. Except for Dr. Wimmer, that creep only seemed to become more fascinated every time he had returned to the facility. Rowan had begun to suspect that some of his previous visits had been completely unnecessary, that he had just wanted to stare at the monster. When he had finally been granted authorization to remove Jason to his own lab, the expression on his face had been positively salacious. And today, when she had confronted him in the hallway, now that she thought about it, he had looked as if he were having a little difficulty keeping his excitement under control. Hadn't that been drops of sweat gleaming on his upper lip? It would be just like Wimmer to get aroused by being in the same room with a detail of heavily armed soldiers and a homicidal maniac. Oh God, too gross. A wave of nausea swept through her, and for a moment she thought that she might actually puke. Appropriately enough, right into the cardboard box on the desk in front of her, all over the stuff that some of her colleagues insisted on referring to as Jason Fernalia, as if it were some sort of legitimate area of study and not evidence of a series of atrocities stretching back 2 decades. At least the soldiers would be handling the hard parts. After all the time she had put in at the Crystal Lake facility, she had come to know a great deal about soldiers. The guys in the detail Wimmer had arrived with all had the look of no-nonsense veterans, including the sergeant, in spite of his pat answer. If Wimmer was clueless as to what he was dealing with, they weren't. However, having seen firsthand what Jason was capable of, she could not bring herself to feel even slightly reassured. All at once, she realized with a sharp surge of dismay that the much longed for good night sleep she'd been telling herself she could look forward to once Jason had been transported out of here wasn't going to happen after all. To know that that monster would be in Wimmer's custody was only fodder for more nightmares, along with the one she was already having. It came to her then as a further realization that the problem wasn't merely Wimmer. While she most certainly didn't want to keep Jason Voorhees at the Crystal Lake facility, she would have felt no better regardless of who took possession of him. No matter where she was, awake or asleep, she would never know a moment's peace or draw an easy breath as long as Jason Voorhees was on the face of this earth. But if she could not destroy the monster itself, she could destroy the detritus that had been left in its wake, and now served as reminders of its savagery and ugliness. When she dumped this crap in the incinerator, it would be like she was burning up her nightmares, if not all of them, then at least the worst of them. If she could not put an end to Jason, she would settle for putting an end to the pornography of evil known as Jason Finalia. She picked up the cardboard box and stepped out into the hall. The soldier was a good 30 feet down the hallway, almost before Rowan felt the material of his uniform graze her arm as he brushed past her. By the time she realized he was one of the guys in Wimmer's detail, he had disappeared around the corner. She turned to look in the direction from which he had come and narrowly missed being run over by a second soldier from the same detail. He didn't stop or even slow down, but she could see the utter terror in his face as clearly as she had ever seen anything. Oh, shit! For a moment, she could only stand there with the box in her hands and stare after him, while a hard, icy knot of fear gathered painfully in the pit of her stomach. She looked down at the box she was carrying, and suddenly the idea filtered through her mind that all this could have been prevented if she had the foresight to dump this Jason Finalia in the incinerator as soon as the monster had been chained. But that was completely absurd, of course. Total nonsense. The last thing she should have been worrying about was dumping anything in the incinerator. She had to. The box flew up out of her hands and bits of so-called Jason Finalia scattered everywhere as she hit the floor hard. The man who had bumped into her stumbled, regained his feet, and kept going all in a matter of seconds, never looking back. She started to call out to him when the air was filled with the deafening noise of machine gun fire. As loud as it wasn't loud enough to drown out the screams. Rowan pushed herself to her feet, and without really knowing what she was doing, took a step towards the room where Jason was being kept. Abruptly, the door exploded outward, and she saw a man flying through the air backwards. He landed almost at her feet. It was Sergeant Marcus, blood pouring thickly from his mouth. Rowan knelt beside him and automatically began trying to help him up. "Get out of here!" he bellowed at her in a raw, agonized voice. "Get out now!" What happened?" she heard herself asking him, already knowing the answer. "He's escaped!" His words cut off. One last gush of blood poured out of his mouth, and with it, Rowan felt his life pour out of him as well. "Damn it, Wimmer!" As she grabbed up the sergeant's shotgun, she hoped sincerely and unrepentantly that Jason had treated that asshole to an equally ugly end. Death by Jason Voorhees was something she wouldn't have wished on anyone, no matter who they were. Or so she had thought. And now here she was with the shotgun in her hands, practically hoping Jason had put Wimmer through some changes while she locked and loaded. Fine. The first free moment she had, she would put facing her moral and ethical crisis as number one on her things to do list. Right now, however, she had her hands completely full. She ran up the hall, taking care to leap high over the machete now lying on the floor in plain sight. The only thing to do, Rowan decided as she pounded down a flight of metal stairs to the underground cryo area, was to lure the son of a bitch to the cryostasis chamber, trap him inside, and freeze his ass permanently. In light of the fact that her specialty was life science research and not strategies for monster killing, it was a pretty good plan. But it did have two rather enormous drawbacks. Firstly, it involved luring Jason using herself as bait. And secondly, she hadn't worked out a foolproof way to trap the monster in the chamber without trapping herself. Jason Voorhees wasn't going to run loose again if she could possibly help it. But sacrificing her own life was not an option she was ready to consider. Not yet, anyway. As if anyone else Jason killed ever had, whispered a small voice in her mind. Rowan shoved the thought away as she looked around the mostly dark cryo lab for a place to hide. Survive now, be neurotic later. With all the enormous tanks and ducts and pipes that fed into the cryo chamber, this area had always looked to her like a cross between a gothic dungeon and a refrigerator conceived by a mad scientist with a technology fetish. What a place to have to hide in. The heavy door of the cryo chamber was open and waiting. Rowan moved towards it, but then her gaze fell on a rack of gas canisters across the room, just as she heard those heavy footsteps start down the stairs. A hiding place with a much better vantage point. She would be able to see exactly where Jason was without him seeing her. Clutching the sergeant's shotgun in both hands, she crouched behind it, trying not to shiver too violently while she listened to the monster's approaching footsteps, each one louder than the last. The cryo lab was always at least 10 degrees cooler than the rest of the facility, and often more like 15, sometimes as much as 20, even when the chamber wasn't in use. The way she felt now, it seemed like a miracle that the clammy sweat from her hands hadn't turned to ice. The footsteps hit the bottom of the staircase and stopped. Rowan's breathing stopped at the very same moment, while her heart banged on harder than ever. Unaware that she was holding her breath, she pressed one hand against her chest, thinking that it might subdue her heart rate, but it only made her shudder even more. That was bad. She had to get herself under control. She had to remain perfectly and utterly still as a statue, because the monster was standing in the middle of the lab not even 10 feet away, and if she made even the slightest, faintest noise, he would hear it and know exactly where she was. That was assuming the bat ears theory was correct, of course. Dr. Charles had said it was certainly worthy of investigation, although she had told Rowan in private that although Jason probably did have a predator's highly developed hearing, there was a lot more to it than that. The frenzy of Jason's slaughter suggested to her that a more visceral level stimulus was at work, which was to say, smell. It could have been sweat or pheromones or even blood, or maybe something else either produced by the human body or just closely associated with it, or some combination thereof. In any case, if Jason could smell his prey, it would be impossible for anyone to hide. Was that what he was doing as he stood in the center of the lab now, trying to smell whether she was in the room or not? There wasn't much light, and most of that was behind him, so she saw him only in silhouette. His posture didn't seem to suggest that he was sniffing the air, but Jason Voorhees had never been long on body language. As far as Rowan knew, he had 4 attitudes. 1 when about to kill, a 2nd when killing, a 3rd when looking to kill again, and another when rising from the dead. None of them subtle or open to interpretation, and all virtually identical. The only real difference was in the eye of the beholder, which was to say, whether the eye was still in the beholder. Rowan pressed her lips together to stifle the hysteria she could feel rising in her chest like turbulent cold water. The monster had stopped to pick up his machete. She saw this, and it was already dripping again. She had a mental image of it lying on the floor when she had jumped over it. Maybe that had been a mistake. Maybe she should have picked that up along with the sergeant's shotgun. Maybe then she would be crouching in the dark knowing she actually had a chance. Maybe the only way to kill the monster was with his own weapon? His head turned slowly from side to side and back again, as if the monster were not only scanning the room but trying to make a careful estimate of its dimensions. As if there was something behind that hockey mask other than the unrelenting drive to kill. She saw his hand tighten on the handle of the machete and knew that he had found her. Now or never, there was no going back. Shutting off all thought in her mind, she jumped to her feet and started blasting. The first one caught him squarely in the center of the body, in the back, she saw to her surprise. But when he had had time to turn around, she could wonder later, she thought, and lowered her aim. He'd have a hard time chasing her if she shot his legs off. His leg jerked as she caught him in the knee, but he didn't fall. All right, then. She would take the easy way out, just blow his head off and call it a day. But her hands had started to shake so badly that she only blasted a chunk out of his shoulder instead. The impact knocked him back a step, but he still didn't fall. Still firing, she sidled up from behind the rack, but he moved with her, and she knew that he wasn't about to let her drive him back so she could get anywhere near those stairs. She kept moving anyway, no point in just standing there until the ammo ran out, and then felt her hip bump up against something hard and metal. She glanced down to find herself crowded up against another rack of canisters, a smaller one on wheels. The idea came to her not in words or even a sequence of images, but as one sweeping action, fully formed, utterly flawless. Her heart gave a sharp leap of excitement as she stepped back and shoved the rack hard with one foot. It zoomed forward and slammed into Jason's lower body. He stared down at it for a second in what Rowan would have sworn was genuine surprise. When he raised his head to look at her, there was a slight quizzical tilt to it. Well, wasn't that amazing? Jason Voorhees had previously four known expression postures. He now had a fifth, the presence of higher brain activity. Maybe she should write a paper, she thought as she took careful aim at the canisters and pulled the trigger. The canisters did not explode in the fiery blast and cover the monster with flame as she'd hoped. Her shot had gone wide of the mark, only grazing some of the tanks on top of the rack and punching a few holes in them. But the gas spewed out from them forcefully enough to knock Jason back several steps towards the open cryo unit behind him. Quickly, Rowan raised the shotgun again and blasted him several more times, keeping him off balance so that he kept staggering backwards right into the cryo chamber. All the lights were on inside and she could see every detail of him clearly. All the bullet holes, fresh splatters of blood from the people who he had killed, the thick, brackish substance leaking from his own wounds, the machete in his misshapen fist, and that hockey mask, scarred and cut, scraped and dented, and forever impassive, implacable, and impossible to stop. Oh yeah? With a sound like a war cry, Rowan hurled herself at the cryo unit door and slammed it shut. Immediately, Jason's head appeared in the thick glass window. She could feel as well as hear him on the other side of the door, trying to pound his way out. To get at her, she realized, as much as in rage as in bloodlust. She had gotten the upper hand and the killing machine was taking it personally. Further evidence of possible higher brain function? Or just a matter of predatory instinct? In other words, first kill the immediate threat, then kill everything else? Like it really matters right now. The PA system crackled. Cryo unit sealed, announced a calm voice, and Rowan almost jumped out of her skin. Please initiate activation sequence. Jason bashed the door of the unit hard enough to make Rowan jump again. It's not going to hold him, said a small, eerily calm voice in her mind. Nothing ever has, and nothing ever will, because nothing can. You know how this works. You knew it when you shut him in there. The calm computer voice was making another polite request for her to initiate the activation sequence when she slammed her fist against a large green button on the side of the unit. There was a loud hum as the freezing system came to life. Cryo unit activated, the voice said matter-of-factly. No shit, Rowan thought, barely able to stay on her feet now. She refused to give in to the urge to go limp with relief, until she saw with her own eyes that Jason was completely and solidly frozen. Only then would she allow herself to rest. But for just a few minutes, she had to pull herself together and make sure that nobody ever came down here and thawed him out again. And if that meant she had to guard the cryo unit personally, 24/7 for the next 500 years, then those were the breaks. But this was the end. As of this moment, Jason Voorhees had been permanently wiped off the face of the earth. Rowan moved around to the door and peered through the window. The hockey mask looked back at her, and she could see Jason's shoulders rising and falling with the effort of breathing. Freeze, you fucking bastard, she told him silently. Freeze over like the hell where you belong. She saw him take a deep, extra effortful breath, then his arms jerked forward and he punched her in the stomach. That was what it felt like at first, anyway. As if he had managed to drive his fist all the way through the door right into her stomach. Then she felt a sharp, terrible pain that was somehow both ice cold and burning hot at the same time, and she knew that it had nothing to do with being punched. Rowan pushed herself back and felt her midsection sliding off the blade of the machete, which was protruding bloodily from the thick metal door. How the hell did he do that? She wondered, pressing her hands against the wound as she took several stiff little steps backwards. How could he slice through that thick metal door as if it were nothing more than soft cheese? The hockey mask watched her through the glass that was rapidly icing over, even as a blast of frosty air vented through the slit where Jason's machete had been. He had removed it, Rowan saw, and now he was raising it high, preparing to chop his way out of the cryo unit and finish her off. Except he didn't. Instead, he seemed to pause, one arm up, and Rowan wondered what he was waiting for. Maybe for all those alarms she had only just now become aware of to stop? Cryo unit breach, said the computer voice as calm as ever. Lockdown in progress. Lockdown. The fog Rowan's mind had been sinking into suddenly dispersed, and she was fully alert again. No! She turned away from the cryo unit just in time to see the lab door swing shut. There was a harsh hissing as the seals activated, making the room airtight. No! She repeated, but only a faint wheeze came out of her. She turned back to look at the cryo unit. Through the window, she had one last glimpse of Jason still in the same position, machete raised for a blow he was never going to strike, before the glass iced over and the cryo gas began to build up in the lab. The air was cold enough to make breathing painful now, or perhaps that was due to the stab wound she had suffered. Or not. Both the pain in her lungs and the pain in her stomach seemed to be lessening, actually becoming more distant, just like Jason Voorhees himself. She felt her back hit the wall and fell to her knees, holding her middle. No, please, she whispered, unsure of whom she was actually trying to address. No one, or the universe in general, or perhaps just herself and Jason together. No, please. This wasn't how it was supposed to go. This wasn't what I had in mind. The blood around her wound was turning into ice crystals. So were her tears. She found herself on her knees, beginning to sag sideways as she collapsed slowly to the floor. No, this wasn't how it was supposed to go, but this is how it is going, and there's no going back. The decision of the judges is final. All cells are final. Last call, game over. Underneath the continued hissing of cryo gas, a deep and impenetrable silence was building, or so it seemed to Rowan. A memory of something she had read about, an expedition to the South Pole, floated dreamily through her mind. Something about how freezing to death was actually quite an easy way to go. Quite painless. You just fell asleep. That was definitely better than the ending Jason's victims had faced, Rowan thought. And she had almost been one of them, but circumstance or fate or something had intervened, and instead of having to bleed to death from a painful stomach wound, she was going to doze off gently into a state of eternal rest. She smiled inwardly. Even if things hadn't gone quite how they were supposed to, at least she would finally be able to rest easy now that she knew the monster no longer roamed the earth. A world without Jason Voorhees was a world that could only get better. Okay, this has been chapters 1 and 2 of Jason X, the novelization of the movie. And I gotta say, even though I've seen this movie so many times, and it's one of my favorite Jason movies, just these first two chapters going in more depth of the story, I'm actually enjoying it. Even though I know where the story's going to go and everything, it's actually been an enjoyable two chapters. And if this is what I have to look forward to in, you know, the next 380 pages or whatever, then that's perfectly fine with me. I can't wait to see this story more fleshed out than it was in the movie. Let me know what you guys think in the comments section. If you enjoyed the way these chapters were written and how the first scene of the movie was stretched out and really fleshed out more, and we got more into the minds of the characters. And if you're looking forward to other aspects of the movie being done and given the same treatment as the first scene was in these two chapters. And I'll be back later with some more of Jason X, the novelization of the movie. Until next time. This has been your friendly neighborhood 80/your librarian saying, thanks for listening, and I'll see you next time.